Okay, good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. So we're glad that we are here in this church again to study the Holy Word of God. And before we proceed, before we start our program, let us kneel down for prayer. Our Heavenly Father in heaven, we come before your throne in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank thee for this wonderful and holy Sabbath that we gathered here in this church, in this temple, to study thy holy word. And we humbly ask the presence of your Holy Spirit that may guide us, especially to the speaker, that some will speak according to thy truth, and we speak it to us as simple to be heard from the listeners, especially in the FB Live. And please forgive us from all our iniquities in thought, words, and in deeds. And this we humbly ask and pray with the powerful name of Jesus Christ, with the help of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So before we start our program, let us hear first the opening song.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you for our SSR praisers for the wonderful song and the message of the song. And now let us give time to hear the sermon of our pastor, Craig.
Good morning, everybody. Happy Sabbath and Sabbath blessings to each and every one of you. It is a beautiful sunrise right now at 6 a.m., 6:30, out here in the middle of nowhere, where I'm looking at the book of nature and enjoying my time with the Lord, evaluating myself, and doing everything I can to overcome this world. It was a bit of a dust storm the other day, so my throat is kind of feeling a little clogged, but it was, you know, you can see Satan's wrath wherever we're going. And when he sees that Christians are trying to connect themselves with the source of life, he doesn't like it. And he's always doing everything he can to attack us, to weaken us, and to try to destroy us. And we've got to learn to stand up in this long suffering and continue to press forward and onward like Christian soldiers, and not allowing him to destroy us. Because when you look at the world today, you can see that most Christians that profess to want to go to heaven are falling into lukewarmness. Their long suffering doesn't show much. They get an easy go life and they can just sit around and do whatever they want and feel no burden whatsoever for the work of the Lord and just play. Or go off and do whatever they want and they get no rebuke from the church or the members or anyone in the world, and they just sink further and further. And if we're true biblical Christians, we're going to long suffer and we're going to carry burdens for others and what they may or may not be doing in the Lord's service. And it's going to hurt the true Christians because they don't want to see anybody, you know, miss out on heaven. And this is why that I've worked so hard over the years through so much pain and suffering and you know, the long suffering and carrying burdens of others, and many being a burden to me. And in my testimony for all this is it's like carrying a big elephant on your back and trying to help so many people, but no matter how many times you talk to them or try to help them, they just keep falling deeper and deeper into lukewarmness. And I saw it with our former church, and it doesn't happen overnight. But gradually, they continue to go back into their former self and feeling comfortable and doing the things of the flesh and listening to smooth preaching and even, you know, doing things with the Catholic Church and what have you, until they're completely consumed by apostasy and so blind, because they never wanted to make a change through this long suffering to be like our Savior and to walk as He walked. And when we look in the scriptures, we can see in 1 John 2:6, it says, "He that saith he abideth in Him ought himself also so to walk even as He walked." And when Satan sees that we are walking to the best of our ability and we're trying to be like our Savior, he is going to attack and attack and attack, and he's going to hit all of our weak points until he can get a strong hold on us and drown us in his apostasy and fall back into lukewarmness, doing the things of the world, where a lot of people think because you have all this truth and you're so smart and you're so wise in the truth, but yet you don't see your lukewarm, apostate, falling backwards condition. And it's because so many are forming a bond of unity with the world and doing more of the things that are connecting us to the world and not to the things of heaven. And we've got to continue to look at ourselves in the mirror, examine your life, and see if you're making a change or if you're going back into the ways of the world and fishing out, you know, relationships you don't need to be a part of, where you're not having long suffering going on because you don't feel sorry for yourself and the things that are about to happen to you because you have backslidden into the ways of the world. When we are truly walking with God, we're going to feel the pains of this world, but we're also going to you know, have the fruits of the Spirit abiding, where the Comforter's going to give us comfort, and it's going to help us walk through this valley of decision where people are falling all around us into the ways of the world and clearly showing them the fruits that they are not heaven bound anymore. And this is the dangers of yoking ourselves up with the world and not walking as he walked, where you become more blind, thinking that the things that you're doing are acceptable unto the Lord. And I wonder if people are actually consuming the bread of truth that I tell you, that when you look at your life and you self-examine your life and you see if you're being found in the faith, I wonder if a lot of the things that you're doing today, like when I examine myself, are these things that I'm doing today acceptable unto the Lord? If he was standing in front of me, would I be doing the very thing that we are doing at this moment? Or when your doors are closed in your house, or you're off into the city, and or you're hiding on the phone and doing whatever it is that you're doing. Whatever we're doing behind closed doors is going to be seen in the public through our fruits eventually, until you're utterly consumed again by the world and not making a change in your life, not showing the fruits of long-suffering taking place. Long-suffering is, again, loving each other and loving God supremely. And if we love each other, we're going to carry each other's burdens. We're going to help each other. We're going to edify. We're going to lift up. We're going to work for one another. We're going to work as a team. We're going to work as a church. And if a lot of people don't want to do that, I guarantee you, it doesn't matter who you think you are or how smart you may be or how you know, you may be lifted up by the things of the world, you will fall into apostasy. And that is a zero in God's classroom. And the things that we are doing in this world today, if it's not speaking for the fruits of God that is that's supposed to be abiding in our life, we're in big trouble. Because when probation closes, that's it. It's over with. There's no more time to spare in this world. We're at the end of all things. And I see that this world is being put deeper and deeper into a trance of sleep, of lukewarmness, bearing the fruits of, I don't care, I'm just going to do what I want. I'm going to go play. I'm not going to do the work of the Lord. And it's like these Christians have to constantly be babysitted and looked after and watched because they don't want to do the works of the Lord. And that's not going to happen too much longer. And so when we take a look at 1 Peter 2:21, it says, "For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us." We got to suffer for him in this relationship. We got to bear our own cross, and we got to suffer for each other. Because if we're working together, we're not tearing each other apart. You're not thinking evil of what you can do to destroy the person that you're about to try to destroy because you're jealous and you have these evil fruits bearing in your life that Satan is working. We've got to do everything we can to be more like Christ, to ignore Satan, to get closer to him, to walk as he walked, so that, you know, you can make it to heaven in the end. This is the most important thing, that we get close to Christ so we can go to heaven. And it seems like no matter how many times I read or say this, it doesn't matter. It just goes in and out the ear of so many people. And it's hurtful. It's really hurtful to see how a lot of people don't want to walk as he walked and suffer like he suffered. Because suffering like he suffered proves that we are on the narrow road unto the kingdom of God. Continuing with 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21. "Leaving us an example," Christ left us an example, "that ye should follow his steps, who did no sin," where we're supposed to strive to do no sin. And if we sin, we have a Savior that we can turn to and talk to the Father and ask for forgiveness, and the Holy Spirit will help us understand our sins so that we can continue to walk. But when you start to sear the conscience with connection with the world, then you start realizing or thinking and believing that you have no sin and that you're not doing anything wrong, when actually you're so far from Christ, you're not performing the works. You're performing the lukewarmness and the blindness, and you start stepping away from the work of God and doing more of the work of the world so you can increase your riches. Or I guarantee you, the day is coming where the Lord's going to stand up and he's going to do something, and you're going to find yourself in a lot of pain because of what you did on your own. It's called backsliding, and when God's people backslide, he comes after full force his children. So who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. Who, when he was reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously. We got to commit ourselves to God like Jesus committed himself to the Father. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes we are healed. It clearly says there that Christ bore our sins. He died for us on the cross. We've got to bear our cross. We've got to do all that we can to help our brethren, and we're going to be in complete long suffering while doing this on this planet. And we've got to continue to press forward and march together and love one another and help each other out like we all need it. And if any of us are falling away and any of us see it, we need to help that person, or it proves you don't love them. You don't care. You just let them do whatever they want. You've got to do something in the work of God, proving who you profess to be. Look at your talents. Look what God has given to you. Practice on them. Continue to work hard. To continue to pray as much as you can and to do the will of God. I'm telling you, brethren, this world is going to come to an end real fast. Probation is going to close real fast. The days feel like minutes. God is speeding up the time. Remember, for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened. And I'm telling you, I can't stress it enough. You got to get up. You got to stand up. You got to do the will of God. You got to obey him. You got to continue to press forward and help each other get there. Don't think for a minute that Satan is just going to let you walk an easy go life. He is going to come after the Christian. If you're just sitting around and doing nothing and thinking evil and watching evil and preparing to, you know, like pre-plan your evil against somebody because you're bored, because you're sitting around and you're not doing much, get out into the farm, get out into the field, get out there with your kids, go out there and do something. Put on some Christian music, put on the Christian Bible, like you see some of the Christians on the property do. Go out there and get close to God. If you're just sitting around and doing what you want, eating what you want, drinking what you want, eventually you're just going to become that same old person. And then your personal probation will close and you will be dead in both works, in the spirit, and literally. And then your probation's over with. There's no more second chance. This is a crucial hour in a season that we are in to get right with God or prepare for the final death, where you will go to sleep in the grave, not saved. So I pray that this has been a blessing and a wake-up call, that you should spend this Sabbath day to look at yourself in the mirror, stop jumping on your phone, and looking for ways that you can connect yourself more with the world because you're bored of the Sabbath or you're bored of your relationship with God. Learn to develop your relationship with God and then seek the kingdom, and that will show that you're seeking the kingdom of God, and then he will add unto you the things that he sees that you need, not the things that you think that you need, but what he wants you to have in this world so that you can stay in connection with him. God bless you all who are contending and striving for the faith. And hopefully this has helped a lot of people out, because this is my mission, is to help people and to wake them up. And in the process, I know I'm going to be spit upon, ridiculed, thought evil of, looking to be destroyed, all those things. But I don't care. I'm not a perfect man. I'm not a sinless man. Neither are you. Neither are you a sinless woman. Everyone has things to work on. You need to stand up and work harder and not allow your weaknesses to overrun your life so that you can miss out on heaven. Because when it's over with, there's going to be a lot of weeping and a lot of crying and gnashing of teeth. And I don't want anyone that I know that I can help be a part of that class. I'm praying for everyone. God bless.
So, good morning. How we feel alive? Yes, no. So, today, no, we're going to continue to share, no, to tackle about the godly traits that we're working for. So, as what Pastor Craig said, we live in this evil world. So, evil world. So, we are being hardly pressed, but let us encourage ourselves to endure. No, let us endure all the sufferings. Let us conquer. Let us bear all the difficulties and the hardships that we're gonna face in our lives. So today, no, we are in this Sabbath. We are we're going to tackle the part three. No, part three of this of this lesson about love. So my part is about the situation of Daniel. So, but before that, no, before to continue, let us first define the word enduring. So, enduring is part of the characteristics of love. So, enduring means long-lasting, patiently bearing continual wrong or trouble. So, enduring means long-lasting. It's not being present in the very short period of time. No, it seems like lifetime. It's long-lasting. It lasts long. No, patiently waiting, bearing, amidst of strong delusions of Satan, amidst of the hardships in life, and patiently bearing, no, in troubles. So, my example to make it a summary, no, to directly go to the topic. Let us open our Bible in Daniel 6. Verse 7. This is the situation of Daniel, that he was being cut, he was being punished by, and being accused to be violator of man-made law, and he faced the consequences, and he faced the decree again in the Babylon. So in Daniel 6 verse 7, it says here, all the presidents of the kingdom, the governors and the prince and the counselors and the captains have consulted together to establish a royal statute and to make a firm decree that whosoever shall ask a petition of any god or man for 30 days, save of thee, O king, he shall be cast into the den of the lions. So, all the governors, the well-known people, suggested or consulted to the king that they gonna establish a royal statute. So, it means royal statute, it's not... Let's not belittle that kind of statue because it is royal. It is kingly statue. So they suggested that they gonna make a royal statue that being attached with a firm decree. And firm means now it is hardened or strong. So they planning to build a statue with a firm decree. And what was the statue? Let us read it again. That whosoever shall ask a petition of any god or man for 30 days, save thee, O king, he shall be cast into the den of the lion. So if we're gonna understand it deeply, this passage, it basically means the statue is means no one will call in the name of the any gods. No one will do any petitions or any calling of the name of the Lord or any man. So, because petition means a solemn supplication or request, or it's kind of being communicating into the Lord. So it's like the prayer is under the petition, no, the word petition. So the statue means no one. Now if you're gonna understand it, In easy way, so the statue means there should know No, there should be no man to call on the name of the Lord inside 30 days. So could you imagine that? Now, because if they gonna do a petition or a prayer, a communicating to any gods inside 30 days, they gonna face a consequences, a decree, a very firm, a very strong and hard decree. Could you imagine that you are being, you will, the violator will be put into the den of the lions, as we all know the character of the lions. They have a strong and powerful. Now, lions have strong, compact bodies and powerful forelegs, teeth and jaws for pulling down and killing prey. And we all know the diet of the lions, they are considered as carnivores. So could you imagine the life of Daniel inside the den if he going to violate the man-made law? So no, could you imagine the face of Daniel? No? Could you imagine the face of someone inside the den if they going to violate the law? And the decree means no calling of God. The decree means no calling of God. No man should do any petition, no, or communicating to God. And back in the situation of Daniel, we all know who was Daniel, right? We all know the character of Daniel, his habit, his practice. He always pray into the Lord. He always ask for guidance into the Lord. He always giving credit and everything he has done in his life unto the Lord. That was the character of Daniel. And we're going to find out if Daniel stopped with this kind of decree. So as we all know, not to make it summarize, if we were going to read Daniel 6, in the book of Daniel chapter 6, so Daniel was not being feel fear or being feel worried about this kind of this decree. But what he did is he continued to call, he continued to pray, and do a prayer even 3 times a day. Now, the decree is not inside 30 days, no calling in the name of the Lord, but what Daniel did, he prayed unto the Lord 3 times a day. So, and when the king knew it, do a report unto the king, and the king they bring Daniel into the den. So in Daniel 6 verse 11, these men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplications before in his God. So a decree, a man-made statue being attached with a decree. So Daniel this time was being considered as a violator of the man-made law. And the punishment, let us read Daniel 6 verse 16. Then the king commanded, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. Now the king spake and said unto Daniel, thy God whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee. So try to imagine what will be the face of Daniel in midst of the hungry lions. So Daniel faced the firm decree, which was he was being put inside the den of lions. So, but what happened next? Let us read Daniel 6, verse 21. Then Daniel said unto the king, O king, live forever. My God hath sent his angel and hath shut the lion's mouth, and they have not hurt me. For as much as before his innocency was found in me, and also before thee, O king, have I done no hurt. And the king was exceedingly glad for him and commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no manner of hurt was found upon him, because he believed in his God. So now what happened next to Daniel was nothing. He was totally okay. He was totally fine. The lions didn't hurt him. The key point or the main point that we're going to observe is no weapon of death can hurt you if God has a purpose to preserve you. Now, endure through the sufferings or threats of death for the truth's sake. So let us not worry, now if we're doing the duty as a Christian to preach the gospel, it is normal to face a we're going to feel ridiculed by someone. We're being face a trials, a test, a hardships and difficulties, for the truth's sake. But let us not fear. Let us not feel fear in that moment, because if God's purpose is to preserve you, we're gonna still alive. You will be still alive if God's purpose is to preserve you. If God sees that you are being used in His will, and you will be doing a great duty and great work, do not feel fear. Let us all endure until the end, because God, if God's plan is to preserve us, we will not gonna put into any miserable situations or any accident to lose our life, if God's purpose is to preserve you. So let us all endure all the sufferings in this world, because just like in the situation of Daniel, he didn't worry anything. He didn't murmur or complain about something, because I am serving you, Lord, but why am I being put into the den? No, we didn't hear such a statement coming from the mouth of Daniel. But instead, he submit into all his life. He submit everything into the name of the Lord. And what happened next? And God found joy in his life. So Daniel was being preserved, since Daniel was submitting all he can do into the Lord. He's not claiming what he did, but what Daniel did, he submit all he has done in his life as a credential to the Lord. So in the same situation, right? If we're in our time today, we will going to face, or some of us are facing now, a hardship and difficulties in life today. But we're expecting to face a great test sooner than, greatest sooner, as like Daniel experienced in his time. He was being, there are someone who report evil unto him. So it's not, we're gonna expect that our life will be the same as Daniel too, because that someone will do evil report unto us to make us evil in the sight of others. Then we're gonna being accused, we're going to be face a punishment. But let us not worry. If God's purpose is to preserve us, so what's the purpose of worrying? As Sister Mawi said or shared last time, if God's purpose is during the Sandilo, in the death decree, so if God's purpose is to put you in the part of martyrdom, so what's the purpose of your fighting back into the soldier of Vatican? So let us all submit everything into the Lord. So all we need to do is to endure everything. All we need to do is to endure the work, endure the hardship, and let us all shine our lights into this dark world. So let us all relax, trust, submit into the Lord, and believe on His plan. Because God is too wise to be mistaken, right? There was a song about it, that God is too wise to be mistaken.
Let's proceed. So what happened to those that accused and seek his hurt? According to Daniel 6:24, and the king commanded, and they Let's proceed. So what happened to those that accused and seek his hurt? According to Daniel 6:24, and the king commanded, and they brought those men which had accused Daniel, and they cast them into the den of lions, them, their children, and their wives, and the lion had the mastery of them, and break all their bones in pieces wherever they came at the bottom of the den. So, did Daniel change his position so that he will escape the punishment? Daniel's true love for God was manifested through his patience and endurance amidst death. He remained faithful despite the punishment he received. God protected Daniel because he endured all those things. So, will you change your position when Sunday law is enforced, when you cannot buy and sell and eventually face death threat? Will you surrender yourself to the enemies and partake their evil mission and be part of them? The answer is no. God taught us to practice ourselves to endure hardships, persecutions, threats, shaming, accusatory, statement made against us, and all sorts of plans of the enemies. Like Daniel in the lion's den, God will also protect us, and He will be with us. And as He promised, that He will overthrow our enemies and will receive a reward in the end. But now, being made free from sin and become servants of God, ye have your fruit unto holiness and the end everlasting life. Amen.
Okay, so good morning and happy Sabbath once again. Yeah, so let's continue about the endurance, love, long-suffering. Yeah, so let me introduce you Paul, and we know already who Paul is, right? Yeah, when it comes to trials, hardships, and everything, I think we can think of Paul. Yeah, so we know already how Paul, or what Paul did before. And yeah, let's read first, a glimpse or the story of Paul. So let's read 2 Timothy chapter 3:10-11. But thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, what persecutions I endured. But out of them all the Lord delivered me. Yeah, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. So we can see here, afflictions, persecutions. He suffered all those things in the name of doing the godly works for God, right? He says the Lord delivered the Lord delivered him. Yeah, so it says there, if we live godly in Christ, then we always suffer persecution. Do you agree? Yes. These know we have a lot of trials, difficulties. It's always present. So that's why if we see someone, like maybe someone is having a problem, can you detect or can you observe or easily notice if someone has a problem? Sometimes no, we can see that. That's one of the things that a person respond to such a trial or problem, maybe not doing the things that he used to do or she used to do, or maybe crying. Some people are crying immediately. Yeah, that's how they cope the problem, no? So different response that we can see from the people. Just like also when I was a worldly Christian, no? When I met a person or my friend is having a problem, not uttering any word, wala siya gisulti, not saying anything, but just crying. So that's how the person cope. Others in different ways, okay? But it's very amazing how Paul did. So he endured a lot of trials. So can we say that he is courageous? Very courageous, no? So who among us experienced so many trials but still able to sing a song to the Lord? It's really hard, no? We know his story that he sang a song inside the jail. Yeah, so that's really hard. Do you have someone, or do we have someone here who always sing a song? Maybe that person is having a problem but still singing a song, no? So okay, let's just erase no. That means right. Okay. Yeah, so yeah, that's very hard for us to really how to cope with such trials. But like Paul, he was very courageous and he was really dedicated to his work. So yeah, do we have to be like Paul? We strive, right, to be like Paul. Yes, he endured a lot and always positive, even or amidst the trials. So we can see that Paul was filled with Holy Spirit, with so much Holy Spirit. Can we say that we are filled with so much Holy Spirit these days? Yes, there are times maybe, like there are certain days, maybe, right? We are filled with so much Holy Spirit that whatever it is, whatever problems I have right now, I am still happy, I'm still thankful to the Lord. But there are times that we are very affected. How do we do that? Like, maybe we really have to maybe think of positive things, right? But I think it would be difficult because, yeah, we are still in the middle. I'm not really like Paul that who has, yeah, filled with Holy Spirit already. So we are still striving. So it's really natural for us to feel that way, like positive, and then there are times that we are negative or maybe not courageous enough, or maybe not feeling not good, yeah, because of so much afflictions or so many afflictions. But since we are biblical Christians, we see how great Paul's love for God, for he was able to withstand all those trials. So maybe he was always thinking about God that time. He was thinking about his mission. Yeah, just like Pastor Craig mentioned earlier, that it was his mission to help people. Yeah, if you are in the ministry. So you don't have a choice, right? But of course, to really help others and also to really be an example to others as well who are also weak, right? And maybe Paul also has weaknesses, but yeah, it's not stated in the Bible, so maybe he overcame those weaknesses already, yeah, because of his love for God. And of course God loves him, as he mentioned, God delivered him. But how about those worldly people? How do you think worldly people respond to trials? So we can differentiate believing and non-believing Christians. So when, for me, I just realized, no, that when they have problems, they think no one can help them. Yeah, they think they are alone and no one can understand them. Where in fact, if they just look up and realize, yeah, they're still breathing. They are still breathing, they still wake up, the people are still around them, their family, they have good health, but they were not able to see that. Why? Because God is not really, for them, God is not there, right? They cannot analyze how should they be grateful to God. Because they are very, like, carried away by their emotions, right? So that's something that we can differentiate the non-believing and believing Christians. For us, we know already that if we have trials, we know that God is there, right? Because we are believing Christians, yeah. So even if we have very big problems, yeah, we still manage to come to church, we still manage to pray in the morning, like we are thankful that we are alive, we still have the chance to be happy today, right? Okay, so yeah, we should not be how the worldly Christian think, when they have trials, okay? But since we are believing Christians, then we should be an example to them. Yeah, so that's why it's very important to share. To share how God changed your life, right? And yeah, are you familiar with the song Footprints on the Sand? Yeah, that's a really nice song, right? Like the person thought that God was always there. I mean, the first part of her life. But in the middle, in like especially for the difficult times of her life, he noticed that only one set of footprints, right? Yeah, so he questioned God that why in the difficult times, like, why was she alone? Yeah, why was it that it was only one set of footprints? And then God answered that, yeah, it was not her footprints, but it was God's, and God was actually carrying her. Yeah, so in the times of trials and difficulties, we should always think that God is carrying us. Even if we don't see God, but we see, yeah, the goodness of God for us. Yeah, not to mention the things that we see today, alive, kicking, alive and, yeah, ready for whatever, yeah, we are going to endure today. So in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, 4 to 10, it says, "But in all things, approving ourselves as the ministers of God, in much patience, in afflictions, in necessities, in distresses, in stripes, in imprisonments, in tumults, in labors, in watchings, in fastings, by pureness, by knowledge, by longsuffering, by kindness, by the Holy Ghost, by love unfeigned, by the word of truth, by the power of God, by the armor of righteousness on the right hand and on the left, by honor and dishonor, by evil report and good report, as deceivers and yet true, as unknown and yet well known, as dying and behold we live, as chastened and not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing all things." Yeah, so we have everything, the positive and negative. Negative trials, but the positive is how you respond to trials. So as what Paul says, long-suffering, kindness, love unfeigned, right? The word of truth, that's what we always hold, the power of God, the armor of righteousness. So we should think like Paul, or we should do like Paul. By honor, even in the middle of maybe dishonoring situations, evil reports. Yeah, and you can see there, sorrowful, things that make us sorrowful, but yet, what did Paul do? Rejoicing. He rejoiced. Yeah, he knew he was poor, but yeah, making others or maybe... yeah, thinking that we are rich. We are rich in fruits of the Spirit. And having nothing, no material things, very, yes, scarce when it comes to material things, but we think that, or Paul thinks that we possess all things because we have God, and especially the fruit of the Spirit. So Paul manifested much fruits of long suffering in his ministry. Persecutions, afflictions, tumults, hardships physical and financial. That's really big problem for us these days. Yeah, right. But of course we think that we are rich. Why? Yes, we have all the things we need, and the most important thing is we are able to still worship God and have good health. That's really important. Laboring for the believers and heathen. Yes, we also labor not for only for ourselves but for the others, helping them. Paul did not give up. amidst evil reports, people thought evil about his ministry, and he did not mind them nor waste his time with them. That's right. That's what the minister should do, not minding evil reports. All these he overcame because of his great love for God and his cause. And of course, God's great love for him and for all of us. So we have to always be thankful, be grateful every day amidst the trials, the long sufferings we have. Yeah, we should always secure our love to God, because of course, if we secure that, then our salvation is also secured. And that would be all. Thank you.
All right, so happy Sabbath once again, brethren. And we already talked about what is long suffering. And now let's continue. So when we say long suffering, we read it not just in the Bible but everywhere. But long suffering is actually no longer just a word, but it is a virtue. It's a character that needs to be developed, especially as a Christian. And it's a character that needs to be developed in a world that is full of impatience, that is full of intolerance, full of overreaction, oversensitivity, and even an impulsive anger, which is so common nowadays, no? And these are evil influence, which is all infected by our human selfish nature. So our human capabilities to improve, it's weak, just like what the Bible says, no? Our spirit is willing, but our flesh is weak. So clearly, we need an antidote for all these evil traits. And we know that the only way to overcome this is to read the Bible and to have the God Spirit. And we all know what's the God Spirit, right? That's the fruit of the Holy Spirit, which is the love, the peace, the joy, the long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, meekness, and self-control. So all these beautiful traits, they work and support each other. So against such, there's no law. And as we learn about God's character, the less likely we think, we are a victim of circumstances. That whenever there's something happening bad to us, we think, because maybe God is, that God is punishing me. But it's not always the circumstances, no? Just like Jesus Christ endured and suffered for our salvation, right? He died in the cross to save our sins and to have an eternal life and a salvation. So if we endured or we face trials, know that everything, even if the purpose is repentance or a reminder, or for the purpose of righteousness or a reward, let's have a reward. Know that everything happens for a reason and it happens for a purpose. So now let's dig in more to why we have to be patient, to be long-suffering with one another. So let's have Sister Ninit to please read the following verses.
Ephesians 4, verse 1 to 3. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long-suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace.
Yeah, so these are really beautiful verses, no? So what these verses actually tells us. So in verse 1, Apostle Paul says, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith it ye are called. So what does these verses tells us? It tells us that we have to walk worthy of our calling. Walking in the Bible is not simply just you know, you're just walking there holding your Bible, okay? It means rather it's walking in a spiritually led manner, which is conducts your life and how you conduct your spiritual calling. But what is our calling, by the way? We are called as the disciples of God to serve and to spread His message, to follow His commandments, because that's our whole duty as a Christian, to praise and glorify His name, and we are called to be His workmanship. We are called to be His representative. So when we say representative, we are to embody a Christ-like manner, not just a Christ-like image, but a Christ-like manner, His character. So when we say wherever you go, you know, people would say, okay, this is a Christian, this is a child of God, not because what he looks like, but because the manner, the character that he embodied, right? So how can you be a representative of Christ if you get anger easily, right? How can you be a representative of Christ if you get triggered easily, if you have an impulsive anger, or you have hatred, you gossip? No, it's not what Christ or what the Bible teaches us. So you have to think about it, especially when we face trials or when we face that someone offended us. You have to ask ourselves, is this what God wants us to say? Is this what God wants us to do? So another question is, how do we actually walk worthy of our calling? Okay, we are called, no? Many of us are called, but few who actually listens. First, we have humility. Humility doesn't mean just like, you're more than me, I'm lesser than you. Humility is about thinking ourselves less. It's thinking more of others. It's not about, what can you do for me? But it's about, what can I do for you? How can I serve you? And we have gentleness, meekness. You're not specifically nga, you are gentle, like you're hinhin, you're hilomono. But it's more of a spiritual matter. It's having a gentle soul, a gentle spirit. It says it's slow to anger, it's slow to wrath, but it is quick to forgive. And it's compassionate, it's kind. Overall, it's just embodied love, because that's how Jesus Christ taught us, is to love our neighbors, to us as how we love ourselves. So we have patience. We know what is patience, long-suffering. And with that patience and long-suffering, we bear one another in love. Though sometimes, you know, we had some misunderstanding with each other, right? It's normal. But what keeps us together, what keeps us unified in unity, is because our love, that is bound towards our Savior, Lord Jesus Christ. And because of that love, we are eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in bound of peace. For we all know that blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall inherit the kingdom of God. So let's continue, Sister Nenet, to read the following verses, please.
Colossians 3, verse 12 to 15. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another, if any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgive you, so also do ye. And above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful.
So that's one beautiful verses again, no? To remind us, to all the believers, to each of us, to be patient with each other, to be patient with our brethren, especially with our shortcomings and their weaknesses, that we want to be treated each other the way we want to be treated, to do not spread evil talks about our brethren who are also striving so hard to overcome their weaknesses. And
do not condemn your brethren especially and treat them like heathen, like just because they still have these weaknesses as you're like, oh, you're not a truly Christian. No, that's not how it is. No, to do not judge. And when there's conflicts, let's misunderstanding, to follow Matthew 18, right? To settle in differences and offenses. But I have to add with this, like sometimes when there's misunderstanding, it doesn't have to always, like we have to say something, but sometimes silence is a great tool to solve the conflicts, right? And just pray to God, confess everything. Why are you feeling this? And pray for the person, and most especially is to forgive them. And to do not avoid your brethren because he or she offended you, except help him because help him or help her because we are each everyone's support. We have to support each other and we love each other and we are each other's brother's keepers. So let's end it with a verse in
Romans 15 verse 1, we then that are strong oath to bring the infirmities of the weak and not to please ourselves.
All right, so let's continue with other brethren.
Okay, so to continue about the topic of Sister Stephanie, if we are long-suffering enough to our brethren or to one another, you know, we also have to be long-suffering and patient, especially to the unbelievers, yeah, and to the people that are in the world, and how to deal with those people who hate you, who are upset at you. So we have to consider that all of us are not the same, right? All of us have different characters and that we are dealing with, and also those people that are in the world. They also have characters that just like us, you know, we have individualities and different characters that we are dealing. And just like in our own experience, you know, we are working in the garden and we connect with all those people, mga customers, like that. And we talk to them. And there are some people that are calm, soft, and easy to deal with. But we really can't expect that everyone is the same. There are really some people who are get triggered in just... you know, a little bit of conflict, or they're too extreme to, like, when you get to offend them or when they offend you as well. We can't really expect that everyone is, you know, good. But we that knows the truth, we have to be an open-minded, you know, that that's also their weaknesses. And since they are in the world, they're not taught, or there's no one who teach them to overcome that. Right? There's no people who told them that, oh, okay, just like us in here, no, when we know the truth, we are being guided, but to them, they don't know about that, then no one teach them to just be calm and to just understand the situation, to be open-minded. And it's just so amazing that how we just deal recently with this one customer, and it's just what we did is just, we really use a soft answer. We just really humble ourselves talking to the customer, because also when you have a business, you always think that customer is always right, right? And it is truly, indeed true what God said in Proverbs 15:1. Let's read that.
A soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger.
Yes, a soft answer plus the word of God is truly powerful, and that stirreth up anger. If they're mad, then don't be mad as well, that you're also gonna no, if they're mad, then just be calm and be open-minded and understand the situation. And because if you'll be mad, then you'll just provoke them to anger, and that will start to never-ending fights, right? Yeah, and the situation will get worse. What about those people that are upset at you? What about those people that are, you know, cunning, hate you? How are you gonna deal with them? Of course, God said na to love our enemies, or to love those people that hates you, doesn't mean that you're still gonna hang out with them, right? You're still gonna get close to them and to be with them or to unequally yoke with them. But God said that if love your enemies in a way that when they're hungry, feed them. If they're thirsty, give them water to drink, right? It doesn't mean that you're still gonna hang out with them. Knowing that they're upset at you, do you think they will not be upset again when they see your face, right? So, yeah, stay a healthy distance away from those people who are upset at you is really the best. Knowing that after all what you have done, you have given them the truth. You have done your part. Like you already rebuked them. You already reason out to them to what is right, and you have done your part. No, you're not gonna seek revenge because that's not love, right? You don't seek revenge to them. If they accuse you, if they did something bad to you, you're not gonna do the same thing, right? But you're gonna stay distance away from them and do what's the right thing to do. And just like how David deal with, you know, those people that are seeking after his soul, what he did is just distant himself. He hid himself away from them. Because imagine if he's just, you know, so close to the enemy, then he will get killed, right? So just like what Taito said, that after all that we have said to them, or like we already did our part, Titus said in Titus 3:10-11.
Titus 3 verse 10. A man that is an heretic after the first and second abomination reject, knowing that he that is such is subverted and sinneth, being condemned of himself.
Yes. After what we did to them, the first and the second, if they're still gonna reject what we told them, that if they still reject the truth, then God said that we will just leave them and God will handle the rest. No, it's not, the vengeance is not for us, it is for God, right? Because if we're gonna seek revenge now, then we don't know that person will eventually gonna change, right? And repent. And then if we're gonna strike them now, then that's not it. Because God just wants us to be as loving as possible, not just even to the good ones, but also to the people who hurt us. No, so God is really teaching us to be kind. Really, like even that's your enemy, but God still wants us to, like, our hearts is open for them. Because God said that if they are thirsty, if they need help or anything, help them, right? But in just on that case, but, you know, staying close to them and be friends with them, I think that's not possible because they hate you, you know, and they are upset at you. And just like King David in his example, he was given a chance to take revenge, you know, when Saul is asleep, but he did not do that. So he just trust God. He did not put the justice in his own hands. And instead, he just allowed God to render justice to all of his enemies. And let's read one of the characters that he always, you know, had in his journey in Psalms 40:17.
But I am poor and needy, yet the Lord thinketh upon me. Thou art my help and my deliverer. Make no tarrying, O my God.
This is very beautiful if we have this kind of character. He is poor and needy. It's just like if you see a poor in the street, they keep on asking, right? He is also like that. He is spiritually asking for God's help. Lord, please help me. Please deliver me from all of my enemies. He just trusts God along of all of his journey, and he just give it all to God, everything. No, because imagine he has a lot of enemies, thousands of them, and they are also using swords before. No, imagine your life that when you wake up, oh, you'll see someone that holding a sword and gonna kill you. But right now we don't fight with swords and all of that. We fought with our enemies. So like we don't hate those people who injured us, you know, because it is not actually them who really, you know, kind of personally hates you, but it is the one who is behind them. It is Satan is our enemy that ruling in their lives, and they became instrument to it. and we just have to understand and pray for them, right? So yeah, we have to lend our help to those, not just to those people who are good to us, but also to those people that are upset and hates us, and that's all.
Hello there to you all, dear brethren. Sabbath blessings to you all. May the love of truth penetrate our lives this day and all that we may learn. My topic for today is in preaching the gospel when people refuse to believe. So if you are in this situation, that when you encounter like these people, when you preach that truth and they will not believe you and they will not hear what you preach, what will you do, my brethren? Are we going to be like Jonah, who go to another side way and not preach the truth to hear that, who wants to hear the truth? So brethren, we must endure long suffering, patience with that kind of threats that you will encounter while you're preaching. We must, like Noah and his family. When you focus on the time of Noah, you can see how Noah preached the gospel and how Noah delivered the gospel without unsa ganang makabitaw ka ng dili siya makuha ng mga evil threats nga kung naay mag, if we preach the gospel and their people are not listening our message, do not focus on them. Focus to those who are back on them, because in the back of them there are people who wants to listen the truth. They want the truth, especially the salvation, the Sabbath, and etc. We should not afraid of them, because the message is not for them. The message is for those people who are thirsty for truth and want to come out of their false teaching. So our Lord warned us and encouraged us to endure, to preach the message. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1 to 4, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust they shall heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. So these kinds of people, brethren, that we must have to face before it's too late, because if you will not preach to them the truth, they will not know the truth. So we must be humble and patient like Noah. He preached the truth even they are not interesting to hear the message. And we see in the time of Noah only 8 persons now, and his family is his brothers, his sons, and the sons of and their wives, son's wife. So let us all come to repentance while still have time, because when we look down through the hands of time, back in the time of Noah, the righteous preacher of the Lord, we can see how he called a world to repentance, but the world have rejected it, just as they are doing today. Many even helped Noah in building the ark and learned of the heavenly truths that gave them understand what they must do in order to be saved. So that's all, brethren, that we have to endure and long sufferings and in patience of that people of kind of evil traits. We must preach the gospel with strong and be patient, and that's all.
Okay, good morning and happy Sabbath once again. So, as for my part, let us hear this example of patience and long suffering and how enduring was John was in John the Revelator, or to be called to us as John the Beloved. Because this John, what I mentioned right now, is the John which is one of the 12 disciples of Jesus Christ. And now let us read that in Revelation 1 verse 9. So we can read here, "I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation, and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos, for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ." So we all know that the disciples of Jesus Christ, when Jesus Christ was left here in this earth, so the disciples were to preach about the gospel. And as for mentioned, this disciple that is called the Beloved of Jesus Christ was preaching the word of God, the truth. But then, we cannot dili malikayan, no? We cannot, what do you call that? We cannot avoid to those people that opposers of truth for the word of God. Even in the time of Jesus, there are those opposers of truth that will accuse them falsely that they preach deception. So in the time of Apostle, disciple of John the Beloved, he encountered also that situation that there are those opposers of truth where he preached in his surroundings, no, in where kaning bisag asa nga area, no, where he belong. And at this time, many of those people were also converted from unbelief to believing. And then the opposers of truth was get jealous unto him, so they reported, no, and John was accordingly summoned by Rome, the emperor, and the emperor at this time was Emperor Domitian. So what happened is, because of many great opposers of truth that had been reported unto the Emperor Domitian, that this John was preaching deception, because John was proving and giving evidence about the Christ or the Messiah, where also we can easily, and we all know that Rome also had put Jesus onto the cross by their decree. So what happens at these times, those great opposers of truth also, they didn't even believe in Christ. And John was preaching about Christ, so they reported it unto Rome. So what happens is, when the Emperor Domitian knows about this deception and report about what he had done, what he preached, so in order to stop him from preaching the truth, from preaching the Messiah, Christ the Messiah, by proving and giving evidence about Jesus Christ, so what the emperor's decree is to put him onto a cauldron of boiling oil. So how can you imagine if you are be put or to be cast out of that boiling oil? So imagine that if you fried an eggplant to a boiling oil in a pan, so you can see the kaning mahimong crisp or makrispy. Makrispy gina ang imong eggplant. O kung madugay, mapagod, masunog, no? So maitom ang color. So it change a color. So imagine that in a boiling oil of cauldron, so Emperor Domitian doesn't only put that boiling oil nga small lang. Emperor gid siya. So dako gid na siya nga cauldron that has a boiling oil. So how can you imagine your life if you will be put into that boiling oil? So you will be crisp. But how great God is was the God of John, our God, that he saved, even in the time of Daniel, he saved those three friends of Daniel in the burning fiery furnace. So how, in this time, in this moment also, he saved the life of John in that boiling oil of cauldron. So while John was in a boiling oil of cauldron, he didn't stop preaching about the Messiah. He actually continued about giving evidence and proving that Jesus was the Messiah. He was holy, he was undefiled, he had no sin at all. So he proved and gave evidence even though he was in that boiling oil of cauldron where Emperor Domitian had a decree to be put it onto to put John in that boiling oil. So at this moment, because John had no harm, the boiling oil didn't give no harm on John at this time. So imagine that if you are surrounded by many people and then they witness that that people, John, was preaching the truth, and then when Emperor Domitian put a decree to be boil him on that oil, and then there's nothing, no harm happened unto John. So the people that surrounded you will be amazed and will be converted. Converted kaning mas musamot. The more sila nga ma-convert, the more they see the more they witness what happened to John in that boiling oil that did no harm on them, on him, the more, the more silang ma-convert into the truth to believe that Jesus was truly the Messiah. So what the Emperor Domitian did in his rage, because the boiling oil didn't no harm on John, so the emperor now is in a great rage because John, instead of to be crisp, no, mahimong crispy, he continued to preach and prove and give evidence about Jesus the Messiah, that he was holy, that he was the Christ, the Redeemer of the world. So by Emperor Domitian rage, they get him up, no, gikuha, they caught John and sent him or exile or to be banished out from the Isle of Patmos. That's what in Revelation 1 verse 9 it was mentioned there, that I John in the Isle of Patmos. So because that's the reason, or the history of that is because Emperor decree, wala na siya mahimo, bisag ipabukala na siya oil si John, but he continued to preach the truth that Jesus was the Messiah. So what they did is to send him away from this nation and to be put to an island, to the Isle of Patmos, where the word Patmos in their translation means my killing. So Patmos means my killing. So they cannot harm John in their nation. So they put in or banish away or sent or exile into the Isle of Patmos, for in them the meaning of Patmos is my killing. Because Patmos is an island, a rocky island in somewhere in Greece. So a rocky island, gloomy, so your nature will be changed. No, the nature of John will be changed. Instead of in the Ephesus, because there's a history that according to the disciple of John also, that the before he was sent or exiled into the Isle of Patmos, he was in Ephesus, preaching the words of God. So, in Ephesus, you can eventually preach the word of God by many people. But in this Isle of Patmos, only rocks, no? He's alone. Or if there's an evidence or history that we can read that there's a few people in Isle of Patmos, maybe a few only. But at this time, when John was surrounded by many people, then he was sent into the Isle of Patmos, so his surroundings will change directly. No, gamay na lang ang tao nga iyang ma-preach sa gospel. But with John, he didn't get easily discouraged about the situation happened in his life. He didn't murmur anything. He didn't murmur against God. What happened to his life? Why did these people ruin my life? Because it is a ruin in your life that you will be put out into a boiling oil and to be exiled to the isle where few people are around, to a rocky island. But then in the life of John, he didn't not easily get discouraged, but became brave and trust the plans of God. Because at this moment, when he was in the Isle of Patmos, according to Revelation 1 verse 9, he was there to the word of God and for the testimony of Christ. Because in the Isle of Patmos, he received many vision than ever before. He was in the Greece, he was in Ephesus, he was anywhere. But in this Isle of Patmos, he received many visions. And that's the reason that the book of Revelation was wrote and done. Because Emperor Domitian sent him into or exiled him into Isle of Patmos. And that, you can say that it is an kaning batik nga panghitabos sa imong kinabuhi, ruin, makaruin sa imong life, or embarrassing ba na? Sana pagtawag sa English kanang dili gidun ta nimo madawat ba. But John took an advantage or think positively that God has a purpose why he was being exiled into that isle or island. So, and that proves of this fact that in the Isle of Patmos he received many vision. So what's the lesson here of the life of John is many people that surrounded you are not your kaning say tawag anak kanang approve gini mo ba, especially when you preach the truth. So there are those who will oppose you, there are those who will falsely accuse you. That's what they did in the time of Jesus Christ and in the time of John. So there are those great opposers of truth, and because of rage and because of jealousy that many people follow you because you're preaching the truth with great power, because John did. He was preaching the truth with sincerity and with great power. That's why many people was easily converted by the truth. And we cannot eventually dili po na matag-an sa atong time that there are those many great opposers of truth surrounded us, and then they will send you or they will oppose you, they will falsely accuse you to be put you into prison, or just like in the time of John, to put you into that same boiling oil. So di ka tama crispy ani, no? So just like in the time of John. But then John, we can prove that John has a great love of God, because it was clearly stated in 1 John 4:18 that love casteth out fear. And in this moment, John didn't fear anything, but trusted in the Lord, and the Lord directed his purpose unto him, because while he was being exiled into the Isle of Patmos, it is an advantage unto him because he received many visions. So that's the plan of God. God has a purpose in anything happen in your life, whether you will mind or think about that it is embarrassing or kanang maruin imong life, you will think negative. Sometimes in our life we will think negative to those things that we cannot admit that why this happened into me. But with God, there's a purpose in everything where He allows anything or everything to happen in your life, just like in the life of John. So John endured and has long suffering even though many trials happened in his life. So dili siya lalim, no, dili lalim ang nahitabo sa life ni John, but still he has a courage to continue in faith, to continue in God. That's how we can say that John is very long-suffering and has patience and enduring. And that's lesson we should adopt as a Christian, because in Revelation 2 verse 10, naani sa screen? Revelation 2 verse 10, fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer, maybe now or tomorrow or to the future. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that ye may be tried. Just like in the life of John, it was a trial of his faith. And ye shall have tribulation 10 days, be thou faithful unto death. So John was proof of this fact that even unto death, he is faithful unto God. And I will give thee a crown of life. So the life of John was an example unto us, to this former, to this present life and to the future. Because when in the Sunday law, when the room will persecute those who keep the Sabbath. So imagine that, no, how ruined sa aton life nga patyunta, i-persecuta because of truth. Just like what they did in John. But we had already a lesson about the life of John, that even though he was persecuted, he trusted and committed all his ways unto God. He trusted God. So that's why he didn't discourage about his faith. He continued fervently in prayer. So that's what we should do as a Christian. We will take an advantage that all things happen in our life, God has a purpose on it. Especially, just like in the life of John, there's a purpose because he received vision in the Isle of Patmos, more than he was before. And that's why he wrote many visions in the book of Revelation. So that's the lesson, how enduring is the trait or character of John, how he suffered long, how patient is he. And that's what we should do also as a present Christian church. And that's all. Thank you.
So good morning once again and happy Sabbath. To continue, let's read 1 Peter 4:16.
It says, yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him be not ashamed, but let him glorify God unto this behalf. Wherefore, let him that suffer according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to him in well-doing, as unto a faithful Creator. And in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1, 14, 16 through 18, it says, and who is that will harm you, if ye be followers of that which is good? And if ye suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are ye, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled, having a good conscience, that whereas they speak evil of you, as of evildoers, that may be ashamed, that falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. For it is better, if the will of God be so, that ye suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit.
So, Peter is also very clear about what we should do when we are suffering. For the truth's sake, there is nothing to be ashamed of. Everything instead, it's an honor that we are suffering because of good deeds. The best option is to endure, suffer, and be patient, nor be afraid or troubled, because we know that we have a faithful Father that we can depend on. We have to follow the footsteps of Jesus, just like Jesus, he tolerates everything for us to be in God's mercy. He takes patiently the mocking and curses of the people, and he still prays for them. If people speak evil of you, be at peace. The truth will still prevail at the end. Be happy when you are suffering. We have to be at joy in every circumstances we will face. Because by doing so, we're glorifying God. Love conquers all pain and suffering. Because it's because of having passion and love, you can tolerate everything and suffer for the truth. James 1, 2-4.
James chapter 1, verses 2-4 and 12. It says, "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that loved him."
That's all. Happy Sabbath.
Abath? Okay, pata guys. Luya na, no? Okay, don't worry. This is the last part, but definitely not the least. So let's revisit the life of Moses and how love, being enduring and long-suffering is displayed into action.
So to start our topic, let's read the verses found in Hebrews 11, verses 24 to 27. "By faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible."
So let's backtrack a little bit to summarize the life of Moses with the Israelites and how he showed love and compassion. So when Moses learned about his identity, he showed love for his people, the Israelites, by choosing to give up the riches and pleasures of Egypt. He did not hesitate to defend them from their oppressors, the Egyptians, and even ended up killing one of them.
And when Moses was asked by God to go back to Egypt to do all the daunting assignments, such as confronting Pharaoh and demonstrating the different miracles of God, he obeyed out of his great love and reverence for God.
Further, when Moses was leading the Israelites in the great wilderness, he also showed love for his fellow Israelites. He mediated with their conflicts, listened and responded to all their murmurings and complaints, even prayed for those who wrongly accused him. Yet with all the burdens that he had to carry upon his shoulder, Moses endured. Moses was happy to help the people he loved and chose to stay with them and continued on, leading them to the land that God had promised to their fathers until his very last breath.
So what lessons can we get from Moses' life? One, like Moses, we need to cultivate our great love for God. Such love moves us to obey God's commands. And when we obey God out of love, it reflects in all areas of our lives. And it brings joy and peace and gives us hope and strength.
Secondly, like Moses, we need to develop our sacrificial love for others, because love involves deep affection for others and not just ourselves. When others approach us, we show them love and kindness. We empathize and let them know that we care.
And lastly, like Moses, we need to nurture our prayer life and dependence on God, especially in times of difficulties. Because when we do so, we have the power to choose hardships or to deny ourselves daily, rather than choosing what's easy or enjoyable in this world.
So let's always remember that God calls us for denying ourselves or to take up our cross daily and to follow Him. There is no easy way and no shortcuts to it. Just like Moses, we'll have to go through a lot of difficulties and trials, even persecution and suffering. However, our love for God motivates us to endure, to be patient, and to be hopeful as we set our eyes to the heavenly kingdom that God has prepared for us. That is all, and happy Sabbath again.
Let's all kneel for prayer. Our kind and heavenly loving Father, we come before your throne through Jesus Christ, our Savior and King, with the help of the Holy Spirit. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that you have given us all to be able to worship and gather here and to learn more about how we can show and appreciate your love, your supreme love, and how we can show it to others as well. We thank you, Lord, for all of the blessings, whether it be big or small, for the enough strength for that you have given us this whole entire week, and that we are able to rest again and meditate in your words. And we thank you, Lord, for providing us with what we need and what we don't ask for. And we thank you, Lord, for protecting us always from evil temptations and evil spirits that are wanting to overcome us. And please guide us this whole Sabbath day until the sun sets, that we may keep your Sabbath holy. And please protect us from evil thoughts that are wanting to overcome us. And please help us to become a light to others, that they may see Jesus in us. And may the topic today dwell fruitfully within everyone, that we may apply it in our lives every day. And please give us good weather, heal the sick around the world, and protect all your saints, and give us strength to endure trials, temptations, and challenges that you have allowed to strengthen us. And we are sorry for all of our sins and iniquities, for our shortcomings, and we humbly ask you to forgive us for our sins in thoughts, words, and in deeds. And all this we ask and pray with the holy precious name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and King, with the help of the Holy Spirit. Amen.